Do you hear me though? Muri kunzwa ndiri kutaura here. Zviri kunzwika here. Ndiri kuti inini. Even the quality of offering has decreased. Quality ya mari ya muri kubvisa. My sanctions are after the home of that in me. See, cut him on Rema sanction. He ran bet more Rema sanction. Rabba Bakashanda Rabashata Tatata Tatata Tatata
Tatata
Yes, Papa.
Oh, when they I don't know me that. Shaka wouldn't have no money. Oh, when they move
away. I don't
know me that. Shaka wouldn't have no money. Ramba, 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 timoni. Ramba, timoni. Rirambe. Pindamu street umaje. Shaka ndandandandandini ndini uchiramba uza Donald Trump kuti uzatishunguruze uza imari kuna papa. Hallelujah.
Ladies and gentlemen, comrades and friends, welcome to the week with me, Comrade Fatso. And what a week it's been. Jonso dropped an expose, a prophet lost a Rolex and threatened drought on the entire country, and if all goes well, we won't have a single sanction affecting us by this coming weekend. But first, sanctions. The government has decided to take the anti-sanctions mantra a step further by declaring the 25th of October a public holiday, dedicated to marching and showing the imperialists that sanctions must go. Because another holiday will definitely fix all our country's issues. I guess with 90% unemployment, ZANU-PF is guaranteed that the holiday will be a massive success. Look out for a raft of new holidays coming soon. Anti-G40 Day, where we will all gather and burn an effigy of Jonso. The week of fasting against economic saboteurs, which will be a major success because all Zimbabweans are already fasting anyway due to insane food prices. And Austerity Day, which will just be a half day because austerity. So instead of improving workers' salaries or getting the country producing again, ZANU-PF is going to fix the economy with an anti-sanctions march. They will send out the youthies into the boiling sun for a march that's allegedly going to cost $4 million, which was completely unbudgeted for. Perfect. My favorite part about this whole anti-sanctions thing was the prayer meeting organized at State House by First Lady Auxilia Mnangagwa. Okay, so they saw investors coming and other hallucinations, but my two questions are, did they pay that dancing flag guy? I really hope they didn't, because... Secondly, who is the guy with the pink suitcase? That, comrades, is true swagger. I think he has all the answers to sanctions in there, and the prophet's Rolex. So they prayed and prayed against sanctions. There were even a few tears. Yes, man. And what do you know? Sanctions were lifted in Turkey. Maybe next time we need more specific prayers. Don't just ask for sanctions to be removed. Specify your address. God is a busy man. An easier fix would have been maybe for everyone there to have asked the guy who was hosting the house party to fix the country himself. So can we blame the West for our current problems? There are 141 Zimbabwean people and companies on the US sanctions list, all ZANU-PF cronies. So these sanctions mainly affect my chef. We can definitely blame the West for many things. A colonial system that left us with an oppressive state and illegitimate Rhodesian foreign debts. The infamous ESAP structural adjustment programs that were foisted on us and mainly affected the poor. But right now, our biggest problem is homemade, deep-seated corruption that we need to deal with so we can build a just and pro-poor economy that works for all. Jonathan Moyo is back Well, not back. His conspiracy theories are back. This week, a documentary exposing how the 2018 elections were stolen was released. Inonzi, Excelgate. I've never trusted Excelka. I prefer Word. Some, like Alex Magaiser, are saying the documentary is important as it exposes ZANU-PF rigging. And of course, Jonso was part of the rigging machine, so he should know. But you know ZANU-PF. This time they use Excel, next time, Onoshanza, what's up? At the same time, it just seems like Jonso is desperately trying to sell his book to pay his landlord in Nairobi. This week, religion and religious leaders were on fire. Not holy fire, but fire. Prophet Passion was brying meat for the people. Yes, Prophet Passion, real name Panganai Java of the Twabam fame, hosted a birthday bash, invited the whole of Zimbabwe, and had Chillspot as performers. The latest is that the esteemed pastor says his $20,000 Rolex watch got stolen at the bash, and now he's threatening that there will be no rain until his Rolex is found. Calm down, Prophet. Rolex yako, we can find it by Zimex apa. Five noj. I mean, I lose my Rolex every weekend kubawa. You don't see me causing a hula baloo. But wait. How will you be able to stop rain if you can't stop a simple thief? Huh? In my favorite news of the week, Chivu villagers set up their own toll gate. Daring villagers from Mapie village have set up their own toll gate, cashing in on motorists who are avoiding the official Zinara toll gate on the Chivu Murambinda highway. The villagers set up a barbed wire gate which serves as a barricade on the makeshift road, which is just 200 meters from the actual Zinara toll gate. Now this is the innovation and do-it-yourself culture that Zimbabwe needs. This mentality can defeat sanctions. There's no doubt that a lot of negative stuff has happened this year, but there are often glimmers of hope, and sometimes we need to take a look at the amazing ideas and actions taken by ordinary citizens to build a new Zimbabwe. With that said, we bring you the hashtag Our Zimbabwe Dream series. The recently held National Citizens Convention said it wanted to create a new participatory politics that places citizens at the center of governance.
So coming out of the National Citizens Convention, we are calling for a new vision of participatory democracy. And with this call, we are basically calling for citizens and communities to reclaim power away from representatives who in most cases have really become self-serving by directly participating in issues that affect the lives of our communities. So we are calling for citizens and communities to be consulted on every issue that impacts our communities, every major decision.
Inspirational stuff, huh? Hilton Tamangani, a 29-year-old vendor, died in police custody after having been arrested during a police clampdown on the alleged stolen police helmets. No one should ever die in police custody. To show your solidarity, support the Vendors March set for this Monday, the 28th of October, against police brutality to make sure that this never happens again. Thanks for joining us on The Week. Follow Magama TV on social media. I've been Comrade Fatso. You have been the people. This has been The Week. Thank you and futsack!